There's breaking news tonight on the president's visit to the UK. And yes, it was something he said. A front page tabloid interview hit right in the middle of his black tie dinner with the prime minister. And what he said about her could not have gone over well. That is just that's just ahead. But first, what he said before leaving the NATO summit earlier today in Brussels. As you may have heard, he took a victory lap on his push for other member nations to boost their defense spending from an agreed on 2% of their economies by 2024 to 4%.
For years, presidents have been coming to these meetings and talked about the expense, the tremendous expense for the United States, and tremendous progress has been made. Everyone's agreed to substantially up their commitment. They're going to up it at levels that they've never thought of before. Prior to last year, where I attended my first meeting, it was going down. The amount of money being spent by countries was going down and down very substantially. And now it's going up very substantially, and commitments were made. Only 5 of 29 countries were making their commitment, and that's now changed. The commitment was at 2%. Ultimately, that'll be going up quite a bit higher than that. So we are we made a tremendous amount of progress today.
Now, keeping them honest, the allies did not actually agree to boost their defense spending to 4%, nor did they agree to immediately meet the 2024 target, as President Trump demanded yesterday. French President Emmanuel Macron saying, quote, "The communique is clear. It reaffirms a commitment to 2% in 2024. That is all." NATO's General Secretary Jens Stoltenberg saying merely that the president's direct approach had, and I'm quoting here, quote, "helped allies to really hear his message." Okay. It's a far cry from the president's suggestion that the allies bought into that message. In other words, whatever else the summit accomplished, the one thing it did not accomplish is what the president took a victory lap over today. In many ways, the performance resembled the victory lap he ran after his summit with Kim Jong-un, only the denouement came a bit quicker this time. Perspective now from Washington Post columnist and CNN Global Affairs analyst Max Boot, also Fareed Zakaria, host of Fareed Zakaria GPS. Max, I want to read part of the op-ed today in the Washington Post that you wrote. You said President Trump likes his North Korea template so much that he's applying it to NATO. Here's how it works: ramp up the alarming rhetoric, escalate the crisis, then hold a meeting, act buddy-buddy, claim that the problem is fixed because you're a master dealmaker, even though nothing has actually changed. Is that really what's happened here? I mean, that's how he left Brussels?
Pretty much. I mean, it's the same MO as, you know, he went into the Singapore summit saying, you know, this is little rocket man, and then he left Singapore saying that the problem is solved, even though we realize the problem is not solved. Same thing in Brussels, where he was attacking NATO for not spending enough on defense, for Germany for having the Russian pipeline for gas, saying that Germany's a captive of Russia, saying that, you know, we're crazy for paying for NATO. And then lo and behold, after 2 days of meetings, he emerged to say everything is great. I believe in NATO. They're spending more than ever before on defense, problem solved, when in fact, nothing whatsoever had changed. All they basically did was reiterate their existing commitment to aim for 2% of GDP spending on defense by 2024, which is the exact same commitment they'd made in 2014. But all of a sudden, Trump claims this is a huge victory for his deal making. And I guess, you know, as he left Brussels, although European leaders were thought this was a bizarre and erratic performance, they were sort of thinking, well, it could have been worse. At least he left saying something nice about NATO instead of saying that he was going to pull out of it or pull U.S. troops out of Germany.
You know, Fareed, one of our guests last night said that basically called the president a master propagandist, that he accuses Germany of being beholden to Russia when he himself is being accused of that, obviously. And then he's claiming that they pressured them to up their spending, but really there's no new commitments on that. They reiterated commitments they'd already previously made.
You know, it's the art of the New York hustle that is being applied to international relations. It's bullshit, it's bravado, it's braggadocio. You manufacture facts, claim that the other side is weak, claim that you've won, claim that the deal you have is the best deal in the history of the world. It's bizarre only because it's being applied by the president of the United States in the most important forum the United States has created over the last 70 years for its security, NATO. But this is, you know, this is sort of the way, I suppose, this kind of New York real estate deal happens. You can tear your hair out about this because this has been going on now for, you know, ever since Trump has been president. What's the
last? That's why I've gone bald, Fareed. I've been tearing my hair out about it.
What's the lasting damage? And the lasting damage is, you know, this, what the United States created after World War II with NATO is really extraordinary. The European security umbrella. There was a former head of NATO who once said, the purpose of NATO is to keep the Russians out, the Americans in, and the Germans down. Now, the Germans down part is no longer quite true, but it still is true that you're trying to keep the Europeans unified, not have them have competing foreign policies. This is very unusual in human history to have all these rich countries cooperating rather than competing. And that's where you feel like Trump doesn't seem to see the damage he's doing.
Yeah. And Max, I mean, some of the president's comments today in this closed-door meeting were viewed as a veiled threat to leave the alliance. And then he did later say in his news conference that he believes in NATO and that the U.S. is committed to its Western allies. The messages, though, just seem it's like whiplash.
It is the whiplash summit, Anderson, and this Dr. Jekyll, Mr. Hyde act that Donald Trump likes to engage in. He thinks, as Fareed suggested, that this is wonderful negotiating style a la the New York real estate market. But this is not New York real estate. The nature of NATO is that it depends on trust and faith on both sides, and in particular on Article 5, the mutual defense provision, which is at the heart of the NATO alliance, this promise that if one member is attacked, the other members will come to their defense. And to have that kind of confidence, you really have to believe that the United States in particular, which is the most powerful member of NATO, is truly dedicated to the alliance. And who, after this performance, can possibly imagine that Donald Trump is truly dedicated to that alliance?
How do you see this, Fareed? How do you see all this playing out in the meeting between President Trump and Vladimir Putin?
Well, what's most distressing about it is that Trump again seems to think that he can freelance this. There's no preparation. There's no set guidelines. And there doesn't seem to have been any consultation from any of the reporting we got with the NATO allies. This was always a core part of the way the United States negotiated with Russia or even China, which is you first talk to your allies, come up with a kind of common position. The Europeans are completely in the dark as to what Trump is going to talk to Putin about. We are all in the dark about what Trump is going to talk to Putin about. Frankly, I think some of his closest national security advisors are in the dark as to what he wants to do.
Well, Max, what do you think Putin is thinking watching what's, you know, all these shenanigans going on in Brussels?
I suspect that Vladimir Putin has a big Cheshire cat grin on his face as he's watching this, and he thinks that he has scored two major goals this week, one with the World Cup, the other with the NATO summit, where Donald Trump, the candidate that he backed for the American presidency, is sowing dissension in the European alliance, which is exactly what Vladimir Putin would like to see. And I'm sure Putin was also encouraged by the comments that Donald Trump made when he was asked about Putin, where he was asked if Putin is an enemy, whether he is a threat. He refused to say that. All he said is that Putin is a competitor, which is pretty much the way that he thinks of Germany.
Fareed, Max Boot, appreciate it. Thank you.
Thank you.
Well, now the breaking news that we mentioned a short time ago, there's a lot of it, all from the interview that President Trump did with the British tabloid The Sun. Front page news, as you can see. In it, he slammed the mayor of London, criticized the prime minister of the UK, who was also his host for dinner tonight when the article broke. He endorsed one of her ex-cabinet members, who's now perhaps a future rival, and that's not all. Details now from CNN senior White House correspondent Jeff Zeleny, who joins us now from London. So, Jeff, exactly what did the president say about Prime Minister Theresa May? Let's start there.
Anderson, as you said, extraordinary timing because President Trump was standing alongside Prime Minister May, really, you know, for the last several days, but tonight at that dinner at Blenheim Palace. But the reality is he said that he believes what she's done on Brexit is wrong, and it has killed any chance, in his words, of a fair trade deal with the U.S. That is her whole point of rolling out the red carpet here for him, is to try and get more trade with the U.S. He said this kills it in his view. And then he said what he would have done.
I would have done it much differently. I actually told Theresa May how to do it, but she didn't agree with it. She didn't listen to me.
What did she say?
She didn't listen. No, I told her how to do it. That will be up to her to say. But I told her how to do it. She wanted to go a different route.
Another remark the president made that Britain is losing its culture. losing its culture because of immigration. And that's, I'm wondering how is that being interpreted tonight?
Well, Anderson, that is one of the reasons that so many protesters are planning on greeting the president tomorrow, simply on his stance on immigration. He was very harsh on immigration. He said he sees places in Europe that do not look the same as they looked 10 years ago, 15 years ago, that Europe is losing its culture. So very aggressive on that front. But the White House tonight, just a few moments ago, actually, White House Press Secretary Sarah Sanders issuing a statement, a bit of a cleanup, if you will. She said the president never said anything negative about Theresa May herself. He thinks she's a good person, but she didn't say anything about the policies of Brexit. So clearly the president trying to make a mark. And don't forget, he's meeting with her, spending the morning with her here Friday at her retreat outside of London. He cannot stay in London. So many protests here expected. Those immigration comments, very controversial here, Anderson.